I'm a scaly.
Ever since Elden Ring came out, I have been enamored by one question. Can I date the dragons? No, the answer is no. But then in my heartbroken state, I had another idea. What if we killed the dragons, ate their hearts, and became them? It's basically the next best thing. And with that, I set out on my quest to become my beloved dragon senpai. We pick the Prophet class because they have the highest starting base faith in Arcane. We name her Alex after Alex Straza from WoW and take the Stone Sword key, which in hindsight was actually really, really stupid because those things are everywhere. But whatever. With that, we're off. And we've already hit a roadblock. See, while there are several dragon incantations available to us right at the start, we can't actually get any of them without consuming a dragon. So I guess the answer to can you beat Elden Ring using only dragon incantations is no. Video's over, everyone! Roll credits! Okay, so obviously we have to make an exception right at the beginning, and we have two logical choices. We can either kill Flying Dragon Aguil or the Great Dragon Grail. Aguil would give us one dragon heart and a few runes, whereas Grail would give us a whopping 5 hearts and a decent amount of runes. I was debating this decision for a while because killing Aguil Senpai would feel more like normal progression, but honestly, since we had to kill one, I just couldn't help myself. I had to go for the thick goth dragon. So, we tickle Grail Senpai's foot for about 8 minutes with this morning star I found, then consume her hearts and take Dragon Fire, Rotten Breath, Dragon Ice, Dragon Claw, and Dragon Maw. I have a sneaking suspicion that Rot Breath and Ice Breath are going to be MVP for this run, but we'll see. We head into the French Folk Hero's grave and expertly dodge the chariot, then grab the Dragon Communion Seal. This particular seal increases all dragon incantations by 15%. Finally, we make it a +1 and use all the seeds and tears to buff our flask. Mana is probably going to be a huge issue on this run, so we need to have as much of it as we can. Now, it's time to take on Margit. Alright, that damage wasn't bad, so let's try Dragon Claw. Oh, okay, it's decent. So it looks like dragon incantations do a fair amount of damage, but I'm sure you've seen the problem.
They're so slow.
Seriously, I could file my taxes by hand in the amount of time it takes to get one of these attacks off. It's absurd. As far as I could tell, all the dragon abilities have the same cast time, and that cast time is longer than the heat death of the universe. We switch to Rotten Breath and Dragon Maw. I'm going to do my best not to rely heavily on Rot Breath, but at least Dragon Maw does take a massive chunk out of their health bar. I'm already foreseeing a huge issue with this run, but it's fine. I'm sure we'll unga bunga our way through it somehow. Probably. There are a few things we can do to mitigate this, at least a little, so it's off to Sealfer River where we expertly dodge the land octopuses and pick up Marika's Scar Seal. This will give us a boost to Mind, Int, Faith, and Arcane, with the trade-off being that we take more damage. Not really helpful with that speed issue, but any boost is a good boost. I also decide to see if we out-Dragonkin the Dragonkin Soldier. No. The answer is no. In Leornia of the Lakes, we pick up the Two Fingers Talisman, increasing our faith. Again, not a huge boost, but better than nothing. At this point, there isn't much left to do, so we head back to Stormvale to take on Godric. So, the cool thing about doing challenge runs is that bosses sort of become like puzzles. You have to really think about what attacks are safe to counterattack, more so than a normal run at least, and you have to really pay attention to your spacing, making sure you're close enough to hit the boss, but also far enough away to react appropriately. Godric does a good job of showing this off. Here we can see my Dragon Maw is just fast enough to let me hit him and get away, or to be more accurate, Godric is just slow enough for me to hit him and get away. A lot of fights in this game are going to be heavily dependent on my spacing. I hope. At any rate, Godric throws a temper tantrum, tries to become a dragon like us, but we just out-dragon his dragon and bite our way to victory. We make our way to EG because I'm lazy and he sells Somberstones up to a +4, so we buff our seal a bit then admire a truly beautiful creature that we are definitely probably gonna fight later. Yoink the key to Hogwarts and break in all stealthy-like. Yep, completely unnoticed. A Red Wolf of Radagon is an agile little pupper, but we do massive damage with Dragon Maw. We also take massive damage, but hey. Okay, that looked like he was in 2-shot range, so as long as we can live one attack, we should be good. Man, the risk I took was calculated, but boy, am I bad at math. Okay, that was really close. I decided if we can get just a couple more levels, it might be enough to push him in the 2-hit range, so we expertly dodged these dudes' magic and farmed them. Then we try again. Turns out after our levels, we are now 3-shot range. After just 2 bites, the red wolf goes down. I can't believe it, it was that close. I mean, one more hit and we would have died.
Hey. Hey, buddy. I got something to tell you. Yeah, that's right. Just a little bit closer.
Thanks for the robe, nerd. We grabbed the Radagon icon talisman, which will increase our casting speed. It's not much, but by god, I will take literally anything at this point. Now we have Rinala. She herself wouldn't be that big an issue, but in phase 1, we need to kill 3 of her little sweetings to break her shield. Sounds easy enough. Until you remember that basically means 3 different casts of our incredibly mana-intensive attacks. I used Rot Breath because of how large it is, hoping to hit multiple sweetings in one shot. Once we break her shield, we use Dragon Maw. Well, that's unfortunate. Had I not missed, we actually would have one-cycled her, but no matter. In phase 2, I actually learned her poise is so low that one Dragon Maw knocks her on her back. Then we just need to use our big mouth while she's spread on the With that, Rinala goes down. We promise to give Rinala a call after we handle her ex-boyfriend, then it's off to the Altus Plateau. We sneak up on the Draconic Tree Sentinel and quite literally bite him in the ass. We're actually doing pretty good, but lightning still hurts. On the second try, we get a little greedy and go for 4 bites, and that doesn't end too well. It's becoming readily apparent that I should level Vigor. Either way, on the next attempt, we basically tempt fate and attack him when I really shouldn't have, but it paid off and we win. Before we take on Godfrey, I kinda wanted to see what it's like to fight an actual dragon, so back in Limgrave, we take on Agil Senpai, and holy crap, that's a lot of damage. Okay, maybe I am the best dragon. Unfortunately, the reward for killing the named dragons are just more breath attacks, so there isn't much point in getting them now. Instead, we return to the capital to take on Godfrey. So Golden Boy Godfrey is, in a normal run, a really fun and fair fight. He has some delayed attacks, a stomp AoE, easy to read and dodge combos, but this isn't a normal playthrough, is it? I found out he really only has 2 attacks that are safe to punish, one of which has a huge asterisk next to it. The first is his overhead slam. With proper positioning, you can get off a Dragon Maw, and Godfrey has the same problem Godrick did, in that he's just too slow and he can't hit us. The other attack is when he throws his axe. This one is better suited for a breath attack because it usually creates a lot of distance between you two, or he will do his little zoom stomp thing and hit you if you're trying to bite him anyway. So why did I say there was an asterisk next to that overhead attack? Well, because sometimes Godfrey will follow it up with a fast axe bash attack. And no, you cannot get out of the way in time if he decides to do that. Fortunately, we do have enough health to survive that attack, so as long as we don't panic, it's fine. It took a few more tries, but eventually he goes down. Next up, Morgoth the Omen King. So this is where the run starts to ramp up in terms of difficulty, as well as frustration. Morgoth marks the beginning of the game's hyper-aggressive bosses. Really fast, infinite stamina, and long chains mean we hardly have any opportunity to hit with our slow as molasses attacks. He does have a few openings though. The best one I could find was after he threw his lance. If he followed up with a leap, we could get a mauve. But even then, if our positioning or the direction we're facing was off, we could still miss. His holy sword attack and his phase transitions are huge openings, but it's best to use a breath attack there, because if you're too close, you just kinda get blown up. Plus, it's pretty easy to status him by breathing on him. In phase 2, he's way less likely to follow up the lance with a leap, instead he'll try to run you down with it. In my final fight with him, I actually got really lucky and stunned him just before his phase 2, letting me get off huge damage on him. Then he did this cute little bloody twirl thing, and that seemed to have long enough window to follow up with. To be honest, I'm not sure if it does. I didn't get a chance to test a lot because, you know, Morgoth became more dead. We tried to blow the house down, but that didn't work. Then we decided to take on the hardest boss, Gravity, who killed us not once, not twice, but 3 times before we were able to actually make this stupid jump. I'm not salty. Normally I just skip past most of the mountaintop area, but we actually have something to collect here, the Primal Glintstone Blade Talisman. This will decrease our mana cost on our spells. Unfortunately, it also lowers our maximum HP, but hey, just don't get hit, am I right? Jumping over to Mount Gilmer, we breathe heavily on a tree spirit until it falls over, netting us the Cerulean Hidden Tear. It gives an infinite amount of mana for 10 seconds, but our attacks are so slow, it's basically just a backup Blue Estus. And with that, it's finally time to take on the Fire Giant. We are literally biting his ankles, and it's not doing very much damage. On top of that, we all know the Fire Giant likes to roll around like a Dark Souls player, and literally everything one-shots us, so this is not a fun fight. In phase 1, I always opened with Dragon Maw because a well-placed one could remove his ankle bracelets in one go, but after that the whole strategy was just don't get hit. Using Torrent, we basically hug him and breathe on him until he got so tired of having a sweaty leg he rips it off. In phase 2, he always starts the same, so we quickly run under him and just heavy breathe directly into his asshole until he gets sick, then run away. Eventually, this literal mouth breather just lays down for an eternal nap. Melina burns the giant tree and we wake up in the great state of Kansas, home to a couple of difficult bosses. First up is the Godskin duo. Normally, they're a big problem, but this time I had a plan. Pillars. Okay, new plan. Pillars, but with spacing. For once, there really isn't much to say about the Godskin duo. I mean, we still had to be worried about this bullshit, but having such a huge AoE attack, there wasn't much to do aside from creepily breathe on them from behind a wall. The Godskin noble actually rolled over this destroyed pillar on me, something I hadn't seen before, but we blow them a cool, refreshing kiss goodbye. I actually fight this demon on a horse because he had something I want, his armor. I was debating this whole run what armor set to wear because we all know fashion souls is the most important thing, but I couldn't really come up with anything good, so in the end I settled for the Draconic set. Without the stupid helmet, of course. And without the chest piece because we're too fat. Phase 1 Malekith has a couple openings depending on what you do. His slow dagger drag attack can be punished with Dragon Maw, but to be honest, it's much smarter and safer just to do the old Yandere thing and stare at him from behind a wall while heavily breathing in his direction. Malekith Phase 2, on the other hand, is, well, he's a bit of a problem. I could not find a single instance in Phase 2 where it was truly safe to take a bite out of him. There are a couple chances to use Breath Attack, but it's much, much safer to continue using the Pillar Strat, and even then, his attack covers more distance than you think. It took a handful of tries, but we proved to this doggo that our bite is worse than his bark. Waking up alone and confused, we have just enough souls to level up our endurance and put on a chest beat. That's good, because we're headed to the Frigid North, towards Castle Soul. Normally, Commander Nail is kind of a pain in the ass, but basically our breath attacks are such a huge AoE, we can hit all three targets pretty easily, and it actually staggers his soldiers. Once they're out of the way, we basically just run away and let Rot do its thing. One bite later, the commander goes down. Before we press on, I think it's finally time to talk to Senpai. All, like, three of them. First is Glintstone Dragon Smarag. He isn't too impressed with our cold breath, so we give him a nice little smooch goodbye. I heard Ezike Senpai really likes it when girls have rot on their breath, so we breathe on him a little bit, but he doesn't seem to appreciate it very much. The nerve my Senpai have. I only ate their brother's hearts. It's to show them how much I love them. Why don't they understand? Last is Borealis Senpai, but he's a little too cold, even for me. I just don't get it. I never did anything wrong. I admired you all so much. Why don't you love me? It doesn't matter. They're all gone. I've consumed their very being, their very soul. I have finally become a dragon. Which just means my eyes are this cool color now. Neat. I like to celebrate my new power with a little festival, so we head on over to Redmane Castle and join the festivities. I wanted to beat Rodan without using Rot, but yeah, it didn't work out so well. So we cough all over his face doing massive damage, then basically just play keep away until we can give him a reminder of what it feels like to chew 5 gum. Next, we head towards Mog. Taking out the Sanguine Noble is... fine. But the Lord of Blood was... another matter. Mog is a weird case. All of his attacks are too fast to retaliate to, but I did find that when he walks menacingly towards you, that's kind of all he does, at least more often than not. So for once, we could actually be more aggressive in a fight. The only time it's ever 100% safe to attack him is during his... transition. In Phase 2, he's a bit more agile, but the same rules apply. When he wants to be all JoJo approach, just breathe on him from afar and hope he doesn't jump into the air. Making our way to Ordina Lethargical Town, and God, I still hate this place, we solve the puzzle and deep dive into Mikla's Halic Tree. Loretta isn't so bad, she always opens with the same attack, so as long as you don't stay in one place too long, you're fine. Oh wait, that's literally all I can do. Our second attempt goes much better, but she literally does this magic attack 9 times. It doesn't really matter, but I just thought it was a bit excessive. Maybe she was mad that we have the cooler magic. She tries living on that anime plot armor, but there can only be one Yandere in this game. Descending further, we eventually meet Melania. Now, I'm sure you all thought she would be the hardest boss in this run. After all, she's fast, and we literally have to stand still for a decade to attack, except we have one little trick up our sleeve. She too can't handle a big mouth. Because Dragon Maw knocks her down, it means we don't have to worry about her retaliating with anything, even waterfowl. As long as she isn't hyper-armoring through an attack, it's free damage. And wouldn't you know it, Melania has one attack that is just slow enough to get Maw off safely, this little uppercut slash to slam move.
Even then, if it's mistimed, she can start another attack right after that has hyper armor, so you have to be really careful about it. Aside from that, she can pretty easily be staggered by the breath attacks, and it's easy to proc frost on her. Phase 2 can be easier or harder depending on your luck. She always starts off with Scarlet Aeonia, which you can hit her with breath attacks from outside the range of. Meaning, if she did only this attack the whole time, it's an easy win. The problem is, she won't. With good enough spacing, and by that I mean you literally ran across the entire room, it's even possible to punish her Phantom Spirits attacks. She'll still do the overhead slam attack, which can be punished, but sometimes she will extend it and through sheer dumb luck you can dodge it, but most of the time you'll just explode and die. On my winning attempt, my back was to the wall, but I guess that's how Melania likes it because she rushes to pounce on us and she goes down. Man, I bet half the internet wishes they were in my shoes. Next up is the big bad serpent man himself, Rykard. I'll spare you the details. This fight sucks. No matter what I did, I would keep getting hit by his attacks, and since he has so much health, I had to rely solely on Rotten Frost Breath, which doesn't sound so bad, but the problem is, if we're in range to hit him, he is also in range to hit us. I gave it a handful of tries, but my frustration got the better of me. I'll be back for you, Snake Boy, just you wait. Back in the land of not gimmick bosses, we take on Sir Gideon, who saw my fight against Melania and thought it would be a great idea to do her most punchable attack. Several times. This fight was so easy, it actually took exactly 60 seconds to beat him. Unfortunately, my victory is short-lived as we go up to fight Godfrey, the first Elden Lord. Well, what's the issue with Godfrey? You already fought him once, and this time he can be statused. Well, dear viewer, that is true. This fight is basically unchanged from the last time we countered him. In fact, he has one more opening than before, when he does that big arena-wide AoE, there's time after the stomp to get in a maw. You might even think there's time after the huge earthquake for a breath attack, and I thought that too, but there's not. None of this is really the issue though. No, the real issue is Horaloo. As far as I could tell, there was exactly one attack in Horaloo's kit that could be safely punished, and it's the same big roar that Phase 1 Godfrey did. The problem is that attack won't come out until he's already half dead. So, how do we safely damage him down? Well, that's the neat part. We don't. And it's here that I had my biggest issue with this whole run. I am convinced that there is no way to hit this boss without being hit in return. And if there is, the timing and spacing required to do so are so precise, it's basically impossible. In one instance, I was able to get off an attack after his earthquake, but I'm pretty sure he just missed due to the game's tight hitboxes. Didn't matter, I died literally 3 seconds later. Don't get me wrong, I understand that balancing a game of this scope to accommodate all playstyles, especially fringe cases like these kinds of challenge runs, would just be a monumentally difficult task, but why are all the dragon incantations so slow? Like I said way earlier, as far as I can tell, they all have about the same cast duration, which basically makes half of them worthless. Of the 13 available Dragon Communion incantations, 10 of them are breath attacks, 2 physical, and 1 roar, but realistically, I've been using all you'll need in this entire run. Unless the boss has an excruciating weakness to fire or magic, there's just no reason to use any breath attack other than Rot or Frost, and as far as I can tell, Dragon Maw is just objectively better than Dragon Claw. Yes, it costs more mana, but it does more damage, and since they have the same cast time, damage is all that matters. Why FromSoft didn't include like a dragon spitball spell that costs practically nothing and hits like a soggy biscuit, but can be cast faster than the entire lifespan of the universe, is beyond me. But whatever, I guess that's why I don't make the games. This has been an issue the whole run, but it really came to boil with Horaloo. We ended up switching off Marika's Sword Seal and onto the Dragon Crest Great Shield Talisman because we literally had to just trade blows with him. Fortunately, the damage from casting Rot, and the Rot itself, is enough to make him do his big ol' roar. All we have to do then is get our guaranteed maw off and run away. Eventually, he dies. Dear Gwyn, am I happy all that's over. Oh wait, did I say it's over? I lied! Radagon is the exact same way! Okay, that's not entirely true. There is one attack I found that could reliably be punished. The problem is, just like Horaloo, Radagon won't do it until he's already taken a certain amount of damage. On top of that, he can actually parry your breath attack and shoot holy bullshit bolts back at you because why not? So both our close range and mid-range attacks are off the table, right? Well, not quite. We still have to trade a few blows with him, but I did come up with a strategy to minimize how many. Before starting the fight, we pop our physique, which has the damage bubble and infinite mana. immediately casts Rot Breath for its full duration when the fight starts. Radagon will respond in one of two ways, either reflecting it with Holy Bolts or with Lightning. If he picks the Holy Bolts, that sucks, you will get hit, they're just too fast. But if he chooses Lightning, you have just enough time to dodge out of the way. Unfortunately, this isn't enough to rot him, you'll need to cast one more time. The best case scenario is he will try to parry it and then throw a Lightning Bolt and you dodge it. He actually did that on my winning attempt, but I opted to hold down the cast for extra damage. At this point, just let the rot do its job until he gets to phase 2 at about 2/3 health left. Then you are trying to bait one very specific attack. When he jumps high into the air and slams his hammer down, if you're far enough away, you can use a breath attack while jumping to actually avoid the damage from the slam. I chose to use Frost because he was already rotted anyway, but either one works. In his final phase, Radagon will do 3 ground slams, and it's actually possible to get a Dragon Maw off after the third one. I misclicked and used Frost Breath, but whatever, just be better than me. At this point, all I had to do was wait for another big hammer slam. Unfortunately, when I got it, I ran out of stamina, so I couldn't do the whole attack. However, right after, he did another slow attack. Normally, I wouldn't try to hit him after this because I would be punished, but I knew he was only 2 damage ticks away from dying, so even if he rushed me, it's unlikely he would have hit me. With that, we move on to the Elden Beast. Fortunately for us, the Elden Beast actually has several openings. He's basically a sitting duck at the end of every melee combo. Sure, it's annoying to chase him down, but the bigger issue is our mana reserves. That's kind of the other reason we had a specific plan for Radagon, because coming into this fight without enough mana would have been devastating. It did get pretty close in the end because of a careless mistake, but we gambled everything and won. With that, we have ascended the Elden Throne as the greatest dragon. Senpai will surely notice us now. You know, if they weren't all dead. But we have one more loose end to tie up. I don't think I forgot about you, Snake Boy. So what's the strat here, you ask? Did I find some cool hidden opening to exploit, you wonder? Ha! Nope! The strat is to rot him and run the hell away, then hope he never does this stupid attack, because for the life of me, I don't think it's dodgeable. It sucks, but one rot isn't enough to kill him, so just face tank his attacks until he's re-rotted and then run away. Repeat as necessary. Side note, you can actually avoid this with better timing, but whatever. Eventually he'll go into phase 2, which is way easier. Almost all of his sword attacks in phase 2 are so slow you can get a hit in without worrying about it. Watch out for that lava though. After that it's just a matter of running away in a massive circle until you need to reapply rot. I was actually so unafraid of his sword swings, I ran in to get a frost proc off. It's much safer to just stay away, but what's he gonna do, slow us to death? Just to show it off, this is the one attack that's decently fast, so be wary of that one. But like I said, everything is so stupid slow, it doesn't really matter. Even with 2 frost procs and 2 scarlet rots, he hangs on by a thread. Man, lots of bosses in this run got that anime plot armor. One more breath, right card goes down. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching. If you got this far, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It helps me out so much more than you know. This run was something. To be honest, I couldn't stand how slow the attacks were. I've always preferred to play faster characters, and having to sit there forever just sucked a lot of the fun out of it. Plus, for Horalu and Radagon, I was just so annoyed more than anything that there wasn't a reliable chance to hit them without getting punched in the face. Aside from that though, it wasn't so bad. I mean, Dragon Maw hit way harder than I thought it would. I am a bit worried about when the inevitable DLC comes out, but hey, that's a future me problem. Until next time, my friends, don't you dare go hollow.